Good evening, everybody. Welcome to 5 of 5, our last worship together for the summer. I'm out of here in 10 days, so it's flown by. I'll tell you what, it's just flown by. So anyway, I'm happy to have this last night with you here. And so just as I've been saying every week, we'll be here for about an hour, and then afterwards in the gathering space, we will have lots of snacks and drinks and ways to try to bring you together. So please enjoy your food and each other. Enjoy the worship tonight. I think God really wants to pour out like an empowerment in you tonight. Like, I'm going to be talking about evangelization later, and I just felt like really on fire thinking about everything today. So just ask for more. Ask for a lot tonight from God in the holy hour. I'm really excited. He likes to, like, you know, we like beginnings and conclusions, and those mean a lot. Well, he thinks that too. And so he likes to wrap things nicely in a bow and give you a nice gift. So I think he's got something great for you tonight. So ask large, and we'll begin here in just a minute.
Please kneel. Thank you.
This is a reading from the Gospel according to St. Matthew. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any man would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay every man for what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord. Okay, so our last night together is our time to reflect on evangelizing, how to evangelize. It's not a tall question or anything to try to tackle in 10 minutes. I'm just crazy and arrogant enough to try to tell you how to do it, so doesn't mean I'm an expert or I know totally what I'm doing, but I will offer some of my experience and some thoughts on how to evangelize. And why is that important? Well, I think the world kind of needs it. I mean, our pews are, like, empty. In the Diocese of Erie alone, they just released some statistics on this, and it said that from 1990, I think until 2023, there was a 76% drop in attendance in church and various things of the like, you know, retreats, adoration, rosary groups, nonprofit organizations, just like a 76% decline. Does that mean people are just like not being born? No. It means they don't know Jesus. Because evangelization, all it is introducing somebody to the person of Jesus Christ and his church, and then he takes it from there. Like, we kind of rope them in into our family and feed them and lead them. So Jesus gave us this task on purpose because it's so important. And you want to say, "Jesus, well, why don't you just do it?" He's like, "That's not what I said. I said you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses." So it's a command from Christ and the church to go and evangelize. But often I think we're scared because we don't know what to do. We're like, "I don't have all the answers. I don't know how to relate to this person. These people are way older than me or way younger than me. I don't know how to, like, engage." Well, here's what I'm going to say. I think if we want to know some first steps, let's look at Our Lady. Our Lady is the perfect model of how to follow Christ and imitate him. And she does three things. Mary ponders. We know she ponders things in her heart when they happen to them, happen to her. Mary unites her will to God most perfectly, and then she goes and makes haste. So let's just unpack those quickly to ponder. What is she pondering? She's pondering Jesus Christ, her son. She's pondering truth as it's spoken to her. She's pondering prophecies as they're uttered over her. She's pondering the word, her Jewish faith at the time. You know, Mary knew her scriptures, okay? She knew them. She lived in them. She soaked them in. They became a part of her. So much so that when she came to Elizabeth and you have these two women exploding for joy because they're all pregnant and ready to, like, give birth to holy things here, they just announce scripture. Mary's announcement when she says, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord," it, like, very much mirrors Hannah's declaration in the Old Testament when she was going to have her boy Samuel. It's almost like parallel. That's not an accident. Mary is human and inspired. She knew her scriptures. And so the scriptures allow her to fall in love with God. And that's what we got to walk away with tonight. Evangelists are madly in love with Jesus. madly. So we want to ask ourselves a question: are we madly in love with Christ? Or are we like afraid to even say those words? Like they sound really weird and creepy. I can't be in love with Jesus. But are we? He's in love with you. He's in love with me. I mean, think about it. Why would God become one of us if we're not that important to him? He didn't need anything from us. He's God. He's perfect. But he came and united himself to us. That must mean that we are important to him. That must mean that everybody outside these walls who have no concept of love are important to him. The sheep of Christ need his love. And only if we're in the Word of God, only if we are in the church receiving these things that he gives us, are we going to know Christ. And trust me, when you come to know him, maybe that just means you're reading through the Gospels, all four of them, you will begin to be moved by him. The way he thinks, the way he acts, the way he talks, the way he responds to arrogant people, which is my favorite. He's just so like, I want to be you, man. Like, you just get it. You understand how humanity works. You understand how to disarm pride. You understand how to, like, humanize every person in front of you, especially the women. And he's a king. Like, what king goes and washes the feet of people? What king touches a leper's skin and watches him heal? What king in the face of being spat on answers in silence? What holy man looks at sin and just responds with mercy? Who raises from the dead? This man is so amazing. And if we take that time to get to know him, we're going to begin to like be moved by it. And when you begin to be moved by Christ, our hearts will open, they'll soften, and you will begin to love him. And when you begin to love Christ, you'll begin to love the things that he loves. You begin to think about what makes his heart beat, what hurts him and what doesn't. And then we will be moved to not want to hurt him anymore. That's called the life of holiness. And then when people see us in love with Christ, pondering his word, trying to live this holy life, they're going to see something. So you and me, just release all expectations of what it means to evangelize and just be in love. Be in love with God and let your life just kind of carry on its merry way. God will lead you. God will put you into the places with people that he wants you to talk to. He'll give you the words. Let's just release the control part. So pondering leads to falling in love, I would argue. And then it gives you that grace to unite your wills. Mary, when she received the message from the angel, it was kind of a shock. You're gonna birth God. Okay. And Mary was perfect. She had no sin. So she totally, in her like purity, I think she was able to understand what the Spirit was saying. And what did she say? I am the handmaid of the Lord. May it be unto me according to your word. Thy will be done. Jesus in the garden. Father, not my will, but thy will be done. And what is his will? This is my body, given up for you. Uniting your will to Christ is going to cost you your life, but it's worth it. And people need to see that radical witness. Because the churches are dying, that doesn't mean we dumb down our commitments to Christ. No. It means we double down on them and get holier, get more intense, get more radical. So we want to kind of get over ourselves and put Christ at the center, not us, and do his will. And pondering in the word, you'll understand what that will look like for you. And then lastly, it's make haste. So Mary ponders, and she unites that will with that statement, and then she goes and makes haste. She makes haste to Elizabeth. Making haste for us, we don't have to, like, make it super, super, like, out of touch with reality. But it's just, like, who's your sphere of influence? Like, where do you work? What are you doing most of the time in the week? In those arenas, in your family life, your brothers and sisters, your children, your grandparents, your coworkers, your church groups, share with them what's in your heart. Just share with them. If we really know what Christ is doing for us, this Savior, this man who saved us, wouldn't you want to tell somebody about it? Like, when you love somebody or something, you want everybody to know about it. I mean, I'm not going to knock again on any, like, Steelers fans here or football fans, but you know where I'm going with this. When we love something, we're all in. I mean, I can't even imagine, like, it blows my mind that people just go watch the Pittsburgh Steelers practice. Like, they go down there in Latrobe and just watch them practice. Like, okay, I guess that does it for you. Great. I'm not going to knock it, but when you're into something, right, you want to do it and you want to do it with people. When we know how radically we've been loved and saved by Almighty God, you're going to just want to, like, share it. And you're going to be willing not to just maybe blast it down somebody's throat, but you'll walk. You'll listen. Sometimes the best way to evangelize is just asking questions. You don't have to know the answers. Ask questions for purpose. Like, you're talking with your buddy and he or she's an atheist and they have no care about anything with God in the world, but they really love the Marvels movies. Wow, why does the Marvel movie mean so much to you? What is it about it that you really like? Oh, I like that Iron Man, you know, he was a jerk for the first like 10 movies, but then in the end he gives his life. I love that. He was a jerk, but then he turned it around. That's beautiful. I don't care what you believe. The fact that somebody can notice that, that's beautiful. That's God working. So there's moments when it can be very clear and distinct, like, yes. There's also moments where we're just with people. And if we're pondering, that truth is in us. And we're saying, God, your will, not mine, every day. And then we're going just about our daily lives. Evangelization will happen. Now, the consequence is this. If we don't go and say anything or do anything or live intentionally, this is only going to get worse. More people are going to walk away and find whatever the heck they're looking for to fill themselves up. We're all empty inside. We're all made for God, and we're all looking for it. We have the answer here. He is the answer. The good news is a person. Him. And we best not be ashamed to tell people about him. And if you know him, you will not be ashamed to tell people about him. Even if they think you're nuts. That's okay. We're already nuts. If you don't think you're nuts, then you don't even know who you are. We're all nuts together. But that's the point. The church is crazy. We're supposed to be crazy in love with God. And that's the point. So let's commit. Let's commit to be radically in love with God. Greenville can have revival. This parish can have revival. This town can have revival. The Diocese of Erie can have revival. If we are willing to do our part, pursue holiness, find Christ in our sphere of influence and bring him. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. It's you. Father and I can't do everything. We're only one person, two people. God willing, I become a priest. My vocation is to sanctify you so that you can go. Father Brandon gave up his life so that you could be made holy and go. Isn't that so beautiful? God gives you a priest to give you the sacraments, to spiritually direct you, to shepherd you, so that you can go and bring more people into the sheep gate and have him meet this crazy priest. Pretty awesome. So, you're not going to hear me talk for probably about another year. This is the end of our time together, at least with me reflecting. I've been so grateful to spend time with you here, just to let you, just to talk your ear off about things that are on my heart. And I can promise you that every day I pray for you, and I've been praying for you, and I bring you before Jesus and ask him to bless you and bless your families and bless your jobs and bless your walk with him, because I really believe that revival is coming for the church, and I would be remiss if I did not do my part. And so I end with the words that we heard in our passage from Matthew when I started. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world, but forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life?
Thank you. You have given them bread from heaven. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, who give us the Eucharist as the memorial of your suffering and death, may our worship of your sacrament of your body and blood help us to experience the salvation you won for us and the peace of the kingdom, where you live with the Father and the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. The divine praises. Blessed be God. Blessed be his holy name. Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be his most sacred heart. Blessed be his most precious blood. Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy. Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception. Blessed be her glorious assumption. Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother. Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse. Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Lord.